sons of the gentry and of the patricians of provincial towns were apprenticed to wealthy London merchants. The parents of these youths flooded into the capital in search of patronage, fortunate marriages, and the latest design in clothes or furniture, or to see the latest play or launch the latest lawsuit, unquote. So London, to recall Sharpe's words, acted as a magnet for the rootless and the workless, unquote, and attracted the poor and the potentially criminal immigrant. Consequently, a sizable portion of the population, actually over 25%, consisted of an underclass of criminals and the prostitutes. In this regard, for Shakespeare, London was a metaphorical platform where a huge variety of people from different walks of life intermingled with each other and constituted an extraordinary human resource which he was to tap for his dramatic purpose. The privileged and the underprivileged, the high and the low, the noble and the common, the rich and the poor, the gentleman and the rogue, the innocent and the criminal, the chaste and the voluptuous, the virtuous and the immoral, all made up this extraordinary resource and were mirrored through Shakespeare's plays. What seemed to be the elegant and socially agreeable London of royal residents, the exclusively privileged nobility, wealthy and prosperous merchants, respectable families, and the law-abiding men and women, was sharply contrasted with the other London, which was located in the suburbs outside the city walls and embodied the dark and the inhospitable underworld of crime and social degeneration. Among London suburbs, the Shoreditch, again, you remember that I showed you, Shoreditch, Cheapside, Clerkenwell, and the Southwark that attracted large crowds since they were the site of public entertainment and all sorts of pleasure activities. At Shoreditch were the two early Elizabethan theatres, the theatre, which was founded in 1576, and the curtain in 1577. As Peter Ackroyd has described with quotation from the Elizabethan humorist Richard Linfield's pamphlet of invective, The Trimming of Thomas Nash, which was published in 1597, against Thomas Nash, the Elizabethan pamphleteer, Shoreditch was a neighborhood where poor scholars and soldiers wandered in back lanes and the outskirts of city with never a rag to their backs in the society of aqua vita sellers, stocking menders, together with prostitutes, sodden and purloined, purboiled with French surfeits, in other words, drunk with French wine, and there were fortune tellers and cobblers and citizens on the search for boozing and the bear baiting, unquote. So you see, this is the other world, the other London that you see I'm going to talk about. As for Southwark, where were located several Elizabethan towns such as the Rose. The Rose was somewhere here. And then the Globe, you see the Globe here, this is the Globe Theater. This is the Bear Garden where bear baiting used to take place. The Swan, the Hope, was evidently a more popular hub with pleasure facilities. In addition to taverns, alehouses, and pits for blood games such as bear baiting, bull baiting, dog fighting, and cock fighting, Southwark was also noted for its brothels. Actually, all around the theaters here were houses for prostitution. In fact, there were more than 100 brothels in London and its suburbs, including Southwark. Therefore, besides the plague epidemics, which often struck London, and the caused temporary theater closures throughout the 1590s and after, there was also a high rate of venereal disease infection. Shakespeare was well aware, through his close affinity with London's underworld, of the unhygienic circumstances in which the brothels operated. Obviously, he also knew how often the city authorities, seriously concerned with public health, had to issue edicts for the demolition of the brothels. As Stephen Greenblatt has aptly described, warehouses, stews, I'll give you the quotation later on from Shakespeare, figure frequently in his Shakespeare's plays, Doll Tearsheet and the Mistress Overdone and their fellow workers in the sex industry are quickly but indelibly sketched along with assorted panders, doorkeepers, tapsters, and servants. He depicted brothels as places of disease, vice, and disorder, but also as places that satisfy ineradicable human needs, bringing together men and women, gentlemen and common people, old and young, the educated and the illiterate, in a camaraderie rarely found elsewhere in the highly stratified society. Above all, he depicted them as small businesses that struggle against high odds, stiff competition, rowdy or indifferent clients, hostile civic authorities to make a modest profit. Undoubtedly, bearing these facts in mind, Shakespeare must have decided to conceive and construct the brothel scenes in Measure for Measure and portray a brothel owner under the name Mistress Overdone, with an explicit pun implying her professional seniority and long experience of prostitution. Now she is the owner of a brothel rather than work as a prostitute. Indeed, he brings the question of prostitution at brothels to the fore right at the beginning of the play. Within the play's plot context of fornication and adultery, Shakespeare problematizes how the rule of law can be subverted by the very authority itself and thus apparently making an implicit critique of corruption among some members of London's city administration for their lenient attitude towards the brothels. Called Madame Mitigation, as a pun on her trade that offers services for the gratification and therefore mitigation or reduction of sexual desire, Mistress Overdone and her roguish tapster Pompey are worried about the damaging effects on their trade of the new anti-fornication and anti-adultery proclamation made by the Duke of Vienna. Pompey, you haven't heard of the proclamation, have you? What proclamation, man? All houses in the suburbs of Vienna must be plucked down. And what shall become of those in the city? Oh, they shall stand for the seat. They had gone down too, but that a wise burgher put in for them. In other words, bribed and used his authority. But shall all our houses of resort in the suburbs be pulled down to the ground, mistress? Why, here is a change indeed in the Commonwealth. What shall become of me? Come, fear not you, good counselors, lack no clients. Though you change your place, you need not change your trade. I'll be your tapster still. Courage, there will be pity taken on you, and you that have worn your eyes almost out in the service. Of course, reminding the Cupid with the blind eyes. You will be considered. In other words, Pompey is saying you will be excluded. Like London's actual brothels, Mistress Overdone's brothel has always infected its customers with venereal disease, which was also called the French disease in Shakespeare's time. This is what her lewd customer Lucio complains about to two other customer gentlemen and teases the first gentleman with a pun on the more valuable French coin that he, the first gentleman, has in fact contracted the French disease far more frequently than him and still suffer from it. Lucio, I have purchased as many diseases under her roof as come to what, I pray? To judge? To $3,000 a year? Ay, and more. A French crown more? Thou art always figuring diseases in me, but thou art full of error. I am sound. That means I am healthy. nay, not, as one would say, healthy, but so sound as things that are hollow. Thy bones are hollow, impiety has made a feast of thee. Of course, it was believed that venereal disease weakened the bones and the ultimately led to death. So the first gentleman has contracted this disease. Lucio is saying, you are more in danger than I am. In the colloquial speech of daily life in Elizabethan London, there must have been various terms of reference with regard to the brothels. As can be understood from Shakespeare's usage of them in his plays, the brothels must have been referred to as leaping houses. The textual references are there. Houses of resort, bawdy houses, the stews, common houses, hot houses, and the houses of profession. In fact, the brothels in Elizabethan London were among profitable enterprises. This explains somewhat why, as pointed out earlier, there were so many brothels in London, over 100, and its suburbs. However, for reasons of public health, and also due to constant Puritan aversion, the city administration often tried to restrict the activities of brothels and or applied penal measures to them. Clearly, this was to the economic disadvantage of the owners. That is why Shakespeare makes Mistress Overdone react against the Duke's anti-free sex proclamation and complain that besides wars, death penalties, and the poverty, the prohibition gone into effect by the proclamation is bound to reduce her clientele significantly. Thus, what with the war, what with the sweat, what with the gallows, and what with the poverty, I am custom shrunk. This is Mrs. Overdone. As can be seen from her text and the Pompey's catalogue of the prisoners, many of her old customers and the 40 more, all great doers in our trade, have already been put in prison by the Deputy Duke Angelo. So lucrative profitability in the entertainment industry, and in this regard, especially the popularity of Southwark, must have encouraged some theater owners to invest in the sex industry. For instance, Elizabethan impresario Philip Henslow and the great Elizabethan actor Edward Allen jointly owned not only the Rose Theater in the Southwark next to the Globe, but also the brothels around. And Allen's wife was publicly disgraced for her connection with a brothel. Aykroyd describes the relationship as follows. In Southwark, there were indeed many brothels, some of them owned by the ubiquitous business partners of Allen, partners Allen and Henslow, and the Henslow's playhouse, The Rose, was named after a well-known house of assignation, in other words, a brothel, in the vicinity. They were, you might say, all-round entertainers, unquote. So it seems that besides high revenue, overseas trade and shipping, the economy of the Elizabethan metropolis was, as pointed out by Sharp, heavily dependent upon the leisure and the service industries. There were endless openings for domestic servants and for innumerable others, from sedentary operators to brothel keepers, whose living depended upon the disposable income of the rich. In this economically vibrant world of Elizabethan London, vagrant men and women, cutthroat criminals, drunkards, rogues, pimps, harlots, prostitutes, mostly populated the suburbs and practiced their ways of self-maintenance. Shakespeare closely knew and intermingled with them. Again, as Aykroyd has put it, for Shakespeare, it was an inevitable and inalienable part of his profession as a player and as a playwright, I add that. It is undoubtedly true that he knew at first hand the depths as well as the heights of urban life, unquote. Officially, the Privy Council and the city authorities were seriously worried about the control of the poor and the repression of the crime, since there was a noticeable growth in the number and the crime rate of the poor. For instance, in an injunction issued in 1598 by the Privy Council, it was clearly stressed that the suburbs were the abode of, quote, base people and lewd persons that do keep evil rule and harbor thieves, rogues, and the vagabonds, unquote. As this injunction demonstrates, crime and the various forms of illegal trafficking were certainly widespread in the suburbs, and the judicial and municipal authorities were seriously concerned about the prevalence of unlawfulness linked with the poor and the vagrants. In this regard, Sharp has stated that the most familiar product of these fears was the vagrant stereotype created in the Elizabethan and Jacobean periods by both of string statues and a lively body of popular rogue culture. But the vagrant was simply the best publicized symptom of much wider processes in which the poor were identified as a problem, attempts were made to control them, and hence they found themselves increasingly likely to be prosecuted by infringements of an ever-widening legal code. Indeed, rogues, vagrants, prostitutes, and criminals constituted what Shakespeare's contemporary John Downham